Hi, I'm Trevor Morrison, Dean of NYU School of Law, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to the 2020 James Madison Lecture. Our lecturer tonight is Judge James Wynn of the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Fourth Circuit. Our colleague, Professor Stephen Gillers, will introduce Judge Wynn in a moment, but let me say personally how honored we are, Judge Wynn, to have you with us, and we look forward to your remarks. Now, the James Madison Lecture is one of the longest running lecture series at NYU Law and our most prominent public lecture. Justice Hugo Black of the United States Supreme Court delivered the first Madison Lecture in 1960, famously in that lecture laying out his view of the categorical protection of free speech offered by the First Amendment. And in the years since, we have been honored to have many members of the Supreme Court, the US Courts of Appeals, present Madison lectures, and it is a wonderful tradition that we are very pleased to be continuing today. The Madison lecture would not have been possible without the dedicated efforts of our late colleague, Norman Dorson, who directed the Madison lecture series for 40 years from 1977 until his death. Norman was our longest serving faculty member, and his longtime leadership of this lecture series is just one of the many important contributions he made to NYU Law and to the law more broadly. We think of him each year at the Madison Lecture. Once again, welcome to all of you to the Madison Lecture here at NYU Law, and thank you to Judge Wynn. And now please welcome Professor Stephen Gillers.
Thank you, Trevor. And welcome to the Madison Lecture. It's never been done in this format before, and with luck, it will never be done in this format again. I am directed to make a couple of announcements. If you're seeking CLE credit, you have to stay on for the full event and look out for the CLE codes that will be announced and shown on screen during the presentation. Note the codes because you will have to include them or it in your attorney affirmation, which you will receive after the event. After the event as well, you will get a link via email to a post-webinar survey, which you must complete and return to us with the code in your return. Okay, that's the technical part of the lecture. Now I get to introduce Judge Wynn. So I last met Judge Wynn, and it may not have been the first time, and maybe he can remember, but I remember the last time. It was at a journalism conference sponsored by the courts in Washington, D.C. And when I did meet him, I knew right away that we had to get him up to New York to be a Madison lecturer. And as these things go, these invitations are several years in advance. So at the time we invited him and he accepted, we had no idea that we would now be proceeding electronically. So the good news is he's with us. The bad news is that we can't have him in person, but we will make up for that in due course, because as soon as this pandemic ends, we will find a way to bring him to New York so we can enjoy his company physically in person, not just artificially electronically. Judge Wynn, in August, I think I've got this right, completed 10 years on the court, on the Fourth Circuit. Before that, he, for 20 years, he was on the appellate courts of North Carolina, including the North Carolina Supreme Court. Before that, he was in the Navy for 4 years on active duty, and for 26 years, he was a reservist in the Navy. He served as a military judge in the Navy. So he's got a really interesting background. I didn't know about the Navy work, but I'm not surprised. And we'll see something about that organization and attention to detail that he must have learned there. So I think that's where I'll stop. Judge Wynn's topic is very, well, you'll have to make the decision for yourself. When judges and justices throw out tools, judicial activism in Rucho versus Common Cause. And I'll now turn it over to Judge Wynn to deliver his Madison lecture.
Thank you, Professor Gillis, for that wonderful introduction. And thank you, Dean, for having me at New York Law School. When I think of New York Law School, I think of my colleague, Judge Diaz, on my court here, who is one of your graduates and one of my good friends. I had to give him a shout out. But good evening, and thank you for giving me this honor to share with you on a topic that is near and dear to me, judicial activism. This is an unusual time, and I'm speaking from afar, and I'm glad to be doing so. To help me find a topic of appropriate merit for this esteemed lecture series, I looked at some of the past lectures given by some of my colleagues on the bench, and I found that their jurisprudential contributions to this lecture series is intimately attached to the concept commonly referred to as judicial activism. Now, I've been a judge for over 30 years, and for 20 of those years, I was an elected judge. So I'm quite familiar with the political sway that the term judicial activism holds with the public and the impact that it has on those who select judges. But while the term judicial activism is widely used, its meaning is elusive. Often it is applied as a term of opprobrium that Judge Easterbrook has simply referred to as judges behaving badly. So in this lecture series, I offer my own definition of judicial activism, which is, in deciding a case, a judge engages in judicial activism when the judge eschews the use of a judicial decisional tool traditionally employed to adjudicate that type of case. In other words, judicial activism involves throwing a long recognized decisional tool, which Justice Thurgood Marshall called a mediating principle, out of the judicial toolkit. Now, to be sure, Judge Tatel proposed a similar brand of judicial activism in his Madison lecture by criticizing two Supreme Court opinions of being flawed as acts of judging. My contribution further explains and expands that definition of judicial activism, leading to the conclusion that textualism, which purports to be an exercise of judicial restraint, is in fact a judicially activist method of interpretation. And finally, I point out that the Supreme Court's recent decision in Rucho versus Common Cause eschews long recognized decisional tools and therefore boldly embraces judicial activism. Why does this behavior amount to judicial activism? Because refusing to apply a well-established decisional tool eliminates a constraint on the court's exercise of its decisional discretion. When judges categorically refuse to apply a long-standing interpretive tool, they necessarily expand the universe of situations in which they, in Judge Posner's words, bring their own policy preferences to bear in order to decide the case at hand. So my lecture will proceed as follows. First, I survey the origin of the term judicial activism and the ways in which it has been defined. Secondly, I set forth why my own definition of judicial activism gives meaning to the principal concern that the judiciary is stepping outside of its proper role and unjustifiably defining and deciding cases based on its own policy preferences. And then finally, I explain why the judicial interpretive methodology of textualism and the recent Supreme Court partisan gerrymandering case of Rucho versus Common Cause are stark examples of judicial activist behavior. In a 1947 article in Fortune magazine, historian Arthur Schlesinger Jr. coined the term judicial activism. He divided the justices on the Supreme Court into two camps: one, judicial activists, and two, champions of self-restraint. According to Schlesinger, judicial activists are primarily concerned with the employment of the judicial power for their own conception of social good. On the other hand, champions of self-restraint sought to expand the range of allowable judgment for legislatures, even if it meant withholding conclusions they privately condemned. But Schlesinger's article failed to provide a viable framework for determining whether a decision is activist. Nevertheless, over the ensuing decades, use of the term has become widespread, and it has taken on a current pejorative connotation. For example, Richard Nixon campaigned for president in 1968 on a commitment to reverse the rule of activist judges and roll back crime in the streets, the latter of which he suggested was a consequence of the Warren Court's decisions expanding the rights of criminal defendants. As the use of the term became more widespread, concerns over judicial activism took a leading role in the selection of judges. And so the proliferation of the term judicial activism has also led commentators to propose a more precise set of definitions for the term, which generally fall into two camps. The first camp of definitions, or judicial activisms, focuses on the outcomes of judicial decisions, whereas the second camp focuses on the processes judges follow in deciding cases. I will describe each in turn. First, the most widely endorsed outcome-focused definition classifies a judicial decision as activist if it strikes down actions taken by the other branches of the government. According to those who subscribe to this definition, holding actions of the executive and legislative branches to be unconstitutional involves judicial activism because it is counter-majoritarian. It involves judges who may be unelected, striking down policy decisions taken by popularly elected bodies, and it aggrandizes the court's power relative to the other governmental actors. At first blush, this definition of judicial activism appears to be attractive because it seems to offer a way to quantify the frequency of judicial activism exhibited by particular courts or judges. But I do not believe that it constitutes a helpful definition of judicial activism. That's because the authority of the courts to engage in judicial review has been well established for over 200 years. Passing on the constitutionality of legislation and executive action is a function that is constitutionally assigned to the judiciary. That means that striking down a statute or executive action is not necessarily activist, at least not in the sense of the judiciary aggrandizing its power relative to other governmental bodies. For that reason, the Supreme Court's decision in the Slaughterhouse cases, Plessy versus Ferguson and Korematsu versus the United States, might be reasonably characterized as activist decisions. Notwithstanding that, in each case, the Supreme Court upheld rather than struck down actions taken by political branches. So recognizing this problem, commentators have tried to refine this definition to treat as activist only those decisions that hold unconstitutional, those legislative or executive actions that do not plainly violate the Constitution. But that refinement serves only to muddy the definition, because whether the Constitution is plainly violated is itself often a subject of reasonable dispute. So consider also that the frequency with which a court strikes down legislative or executive actions may be just a function of the cases that the court is called on to decide. The inescapable conclusion is that this definition is simply unhelpful. Another outcome-focused definition of judicial activism defines a decision as activist if it overturns precedent. This type of outcome-focused definition is concerned with courts aggrandizing their power relative to their predecessors and with the courts treating similarly situated people differently over time. But I'm not persuaded by this definition. That's because if a line of precedent has proven unworkable or is plainly wrong, it is unfair to condemn it as an activist decision overturning an errant line of precedent. And that's especially true when the line of precedent itself can be reasonably characterized as activist, which means that any decisions that follow rather than overturn that precedent would amount to judicial activism. As Justice Kavanaugh recently noted, all current Supreme Court justices agree that it is sometimes appropriate for the court to overrule erroneous decisions. Another outcome-focused definition of judicial activism deems activists all those decisions that amount to a judge legislating from the bench. This type of outcome-focused definition is grounded in the notion that the political branches, not the judiciary, are constitutionally responsible for making policy. This definition emphasizes that judges who are appointed rather than elected are not accountable to the electorate and should not be in the business of establishing policy. I agree that judging fulfills a different constitutional role and involves a fundamentally different exercise than legislating. Judge Posner explained it this way: what can fairly be inferred from the constitutional scheme is that judges are not to exercise the same free-willing legislative discretion as the elected representatives. Well, because of that, numerous constraints circumscribe judicial discretion. But as Judge Posner has also recognized, there are times when the guidance provided by those strengths runs dry. In those situations, a court cannot fulfill its obligation to decide the case before it without exercising something akin to the policymaking discretion that the Constitution typically reserves to the political branches. That leads us to reason that it is the unjustified exercise of policymaking discretion, not the exercise of the discretion itself, that renders judicial policymaking activist. As should be apparent, I do not subscribe to any of the outcome-focused definitions of judicial activism. That being the case, I now turn to look instead at some of the process-focused definitions. Process focuses on the procedures for resolving disputes through the court system. It is part of the glue that holds together democracies like our own. Judges protect that process. They are expected to enforce the rules, but they also are expected to play by them themselves. In my view, any account of judicial activism must be grounded in process. Yet I think existing process-focused definitions fail to account for the full scope of harm that judges can cause when shirking their duties as guardians of process. One such definition involves a court reaching out to decide an issue not before it. This process-focused definition of judicial activism is bound up with the notion that, absent exceptional circumstances, courts are supposed to resolve only those issues presented by the parties. It is supported by the Constitution's case and controversy requirement and our adversarial legal system, which do not endow courts with free-willing authority to encroach on litigants' responsibility to define the universe of issues for judicial resolution. But this process-focused definition of judicial activism, that a court should not decide an issue before it, is also incomplete. That's because it takes little imagination to identify other ways in which a court would be acting outside of its proper sphere, such as ignoring critical facts or failing to follow formal rules of procedure. Another process-focused definition of judicial activism treats as activists those decisions that are not minimalist. Minimalist decisions are narrow and avoid complex or contentious issues. On the other hand, maximalist opinions feature sweeping rules or address questions that could have been avoided. The belief is that maximalist judges are activists because they expand judicial discretion by reaching issues beyond those presented by the case at hand. But minimalist judges have also been viewed as judicial activists because they leave future courts with greater freedom to exercise discretion. As Justice Scalia explained, When an appellate court adopts a general rule rather than limiting its decision to the facts of the case, the court not only constrains lower courts, it constrains itself as well. Another type of process-focused judicial activism treats as activist any judicial decision that fails to follow a preferred interpretive method, such as textualism or originalism. But this approach just folds the definition of activism into the dispute about proper interpretive methods, depriving the term judicial activism of any independent meaning. Now that I have discussed the most common definitions of judicial activism, I will turn to my own definition, which falls into the process category. Judicial activism occurs when a judge deliberately avoids the use of a decisional tool that has been traditionally used to adjudicate that type of case. Suppose, for example, that in deciding a particular legal question, it is well established that courts traditionally consider judicial interpretive tools A, B, C, and D. If a judge refuses to apply D, not because D was not relevant in the particular case, but instead due to his or her own policy-based opposition to the use of the interpretive tool D, then that judge is engaging in judicial activism. That's because by rejecting D, the judge increases the circumstances in which it is permissible for the judge to decide cases based on his or her own policy preferences. My main concern is that judges who frame their opinions to circumvent well-recognized and long-standing constraints on judicial decision-making unnecessarily expand the universe of situations when they can decide cases based on their personal policy preferences. They are, in my opinion, engaging in judicial activism. In other words, eschewing a well-established decisional tool enhances the court's power relative to the political branches, past courts, and future courts. Suppose, for example, a traditional decisional tool requires the court to defer to an administrative agency's construction of an ambiguous statute, but a judge chooses not to follow that practice. By ignoring the decisional tool of deferring to an agency's interpretation of the statute, the judge necessarily enhances his or her discretionary power because now the judge would be able to set aside not only the agency rules that conflict with the plain language of the statute, but also those that conflict with what the judge personally believes is the better reading of an ambiguous statute. Additionally, when a judge eschews or refuses to apply a well-established decisional tool, he or she effectively overrules the precedents of those decisions in which courts have treated that decision or tools as a critical feature of judicial decision-making. Justice Thurgood Marshall explained it this way. Justices who would discard the mediating principles embodied in precedent must explain why they are entitled to substitute their mediating principles for those that are already settled in law. In essence, by categorically rejecting a long-applied decisional tool, a judge departs from the wisdom of his or her predecessors, in stark tension with the common law system adopted by the framers and practiced by the judiciary since its inception. Not using well-established decisional tools also strains the constitutional balance in separation of powers. For example, where courts have long interpreted statutes according to a certain method, Congress is likely to have relied on that procedure. As Professor Michael Gerhardt has noted, a court that overrules too many precedents signals permission for other branches to view its decisions with the same lack of respect with which it views them, threatening harm to the constitutional order. Another benefit of my view of judicial activism is that these decisional tools have emerged from a lengthy process of reviewing and resolving cases conducted by judges across time and across the ideological spectrum. That is, these tools are not only beneficial because they are widely accepted, they also ground decision judicial making in rules that have been adopted in contexts that lack the bitterness of partisan bickering. The same cannot be said of definitions of judicial activism that rely on, for example, substantive views about proper constitutional interpretation. But I emphasize that some judicial tools, by their terms, do not and should not come into play in every case. For instance, the rule of lenity, which holds that ambiguities in criminal statutes should be read in a defendant's favor, applies only if a statute remains ambiguous after the court has consulted the traditional canons of statutory construction. So under my definition, the failure to consider the rule of lenity is activist only if the condition preceded to applying the rule that the statute is ambiguous, even after considering the statute's plain language and applying traditional canons of statutory interpretation, has been satisfied. Likewise, under my definition, a court generally does not engage in judicial activism if it determines that a decisional tool does not warrant decisive weight in a specific case. In many cases, well-established decisional tools may point in different directions, requiring a court to exercise its judgment in determining which decisional tool to follow. For example, a court tasked with interpreting a statute may find that two well-established canons of construction point to conflicting interpretations of the statutory language at issue. And in other cases, a well-established decisional tool may provide little guidance, meaning that the court is left to look at other interpretive decisional tools. But in my view, when a court declines to give weight to a particular well-established decisional tool or reaches a result contrary to the outcome a particular decisional tool supports, it is critical that the court refer to that tool and explain why it is declining to follow it. As Professor H. Jefferson Powell eloquently put it, because the Constitution is not a crossword puzzle with only one right answer, playing the constitutional law game fairly demands that the players be clear about why they give the answers they do. Candor is indispensable if the system is to retain its moral dignity. So transparency serves several purposes. It helps the public and other courts understand and critique a court's decision not to treat the interpreted tool as decisive. It aids the political branches in understanding how courts will analyze the constitutionality or legality of their policy decisions. And it rebuts claims that the court is engaging in a sort of result-oriented decision-making that is often reviewed as activist. In the words of Professor Aaron Bottrin, it is when decisive underlying judgments remain obscure that critics can most credibly read illegitimate motivations into a decision. Transparency also resolves what I expect to be the chief criticism of my definition of judicial activism, that disagreements over proper interpretive tools make it difficult to determine when a judge is being activist or merely employing a less well-accepted tool. But judges should transparently explain why they are using one tool over others. When they do, that transparency meaningfully contributes to discussion about the appropriate interpretive tools that should be used in similar cases. Transparency helps observers to determine whether a judge who chooses to use a less accepted tool is behaving as an activist judge. The bottom line is that being transparent allows the judge to demonstrate principal reasons for employing an unconventional approach, rather than leaving the public other courts and other judges to guess what the judge was thinking. Again, under my definition, judicial activism occurs when in deciding a case, a judge deliberately avoids the use of a tool traditionally employed to adjudicate that type of case. I will now discuss, under my definition, the interpretive method called textualism, why it is no more than just an exercise of judicial activism. Secondly, I will discuss why the Supreme Court's recent opinion in Rucho versus Common Cause is a blatantly activist opinion because it unabashedly expands the reach of the justice's discretion by eschewing traditional decisional tools. First, the rather recently judicially created interpretive method of textualism began to take hold in the 1980s and continues to maintain faithful adherence on the Supreme Court. Professor William Etheridge defines textualists as being, in general, those judges who maintain that statutory text is the alpha and the omega of statutory interpretation and that legislative history should almost never be consulted. Textualists object to using legislative history to interpret statutes because of legal and policy concerns. As to the legal concern, textualists say that Congress enacted the statutory language, not the statute's legislative history. Textualists also say that relying on legislative history allows an impermissible self-delegation of legislative power by the subset of legislators who draft committee reports and materials for the legislative record. As to the policy concern, textualists point to the difficulty of ascertaining the intent of a collective body like Congress from records prepared by a subset of legislators or from the statements of individual legislators. But by refusing to consider legislative history in construing statutes, textualists reject the well-established and traditional decisional tool used for statutory construction during most of the last century, commonly referred to as purposivism. In his Madison lecture dealing with statute, Judge Katzmann explained that purposivism is premised on the view that legislation is purposive. And judges should construe statutes to execute that legislative purpose. That is, Judge Katzmann said, the task of the judge is to make sense of legislation in a way that is faithful to Congress's purposes. Judges who, in construing a statute, seek to be faithful to Congress's purposes rely on numerous tools to ascertain a statutory provision's meaning, the text, the statutory structure, canons of construction, analogous statutory provisions, common law usages, and agency interpretations, to name just a few. Purposivists, unlike textualists, believe that legislative history can serve as a useful tool in understanding the meaning and application of a statutory provision, especially when the statutory provision is silent and unclear on an issue. Courts that consider legislative history recognize that legislators themselves use such extra textual sources. As Judge Katzmann put it, legislators rely on the work of colleagues on other committees and become educated about the bill by reading the materials produced by the committees and conference committees from which the proposed legislation emanates. Under my definition of judicial activism, textualist is a fundamentally activist approach to judicial decision-making because textualists categorically reject a long-recognized tool for statutory construction, legislative history. That categorical rejection expands the universe of situations in which a court can rest a decision on its own policy preferences. Thus, the claim that textualism is the only non-activist approach to statutory interpretation is simple gobbledygook for two reasons. First, textualists often incorrectly assume that the meaning of statutory text is sufficiently determinant on its own that a court would not need to exercise policymaking discretion to interpret it. Secondly, textualists wrongly assert that the wide diversity of legislative history materials gives courts the freedom to selectively rely only on those materials that support their preferred policy results. I'll address each. In the first place, the textualist claim, that is, that statutory text is usually determining and the court does not need to exercise policymaking discretion, runs contrary to my 30 years as an experience as a judge, during which time I've heard numerous cases, including involving statutes that were ambiguous or salient as to the issue at hand. Judge Katzmann indicated the same in his Madison lecture. Our experiences are not aberrations. James Madison himself recognized long ago in the Federalist Papers that all new laws, no matter how thoroughly deliberated and skillfully crafted, are somewhat obscure until their meaning is ascertained by a series of particular discussions and adjudications. Madison explained that this is because no language is so copious as to supply words and phrases for every complex idea, or so correct as not to include many equivocally denoting different ideas. Also, the circumstances in which a statute applies over time, in fact, occur when a judge often is required to apply statutes to factual scenarios that the authoring legislators could not have imagined, much less addressed. Consider, for example, that courts are regularly called on to construe and apply statutes long ago enacted, such as the Sherman Antitrust Act of 1890 and the Fair Labor Standards Act of 1938. These two acts illustrate the essential difficulty of using words in the statutory context to convey ideas and to foresee all possible applications of the statutes to changing circumstances. The result is that today, there's a broad array of situations in which the text of those statutes will not be dispositive. So by eschewing the traditional decisional tool of legislative history, which could assist in determining the ideas and applications that the legislature intended, textualists instead increase their opportunities to bring their own policy preferences to bear. That's because the appropriate use of legislative history is a meaningful additional constraint on judicial discretion. If the tools of statutory construction do not decisively answer a particular question, then a court that considers legislative history remains constrained by the congressional guidance provided in authoritative legislative history. In the end, by restricting the use of decisional tools available to judges and claiming wrongly that such restrictions constrain judicial discretion, textualists simply shut their eyes to the power that textualists confers on judges. Secondly, I do not agree with the textualist argument that judges who faithfully apply well-established decisional tools will be able to selectively rely on one piece of available legislative history or another to support their preferred result. That argument fails to account for the existence of well-established decisional tools regarding how judges should use the legislative history. For instance, it is well established as a decisional tool that courts generally should give greater interpretive weight to committee and conference reports than statements of individual legislators. That's because those reports are likely to reflect the considered judgment of the legislators responsible for drafting the legislation and are widely relied on by the legislators. Likewise, it is a well-established decisional tool that courts should not treat as decisive legislative history that is ambiguous or contradicts the plain text of the statute. And another well-established decisional tool is that courts should treat legislative history as only one component of a larger inquiry into the proper construction of a judgment, of a statute, using the other well-established interpretive tools as well. Courts that faithfully follow these decisional tools do not cherry pick stray pieces of legislative history to construe a statute. Instead, those courts are constrained by the weight of the interpretive tools at their disposal. If a court appropriately uses legislative history, it is no more free to reach its preferred policy result than if it did not consult the legislative history. In fact, the court is less free to use its discretion because it's chosen the interpretation of the statute must not only reflect careful consideration of the interpretive tools relied on by textualists, but also any additional guidance provided by legislative history. As an example, I recently served on a panel in which we were called on to determine whether previously delivered and open emails stored by a web-based email service or in electronic storage for purposes of the Stored Communication Act. But because web-based email did not exist at the time Congress enacted the statute in 1986, the plain language of the statute was not free from ambiguity. So while the Act defined electronic storage as the storage of a wire or electronic communication for purposes of backup protection, the Act did not define backup. And dictionaries that define the words did so in a variety of ways. But a consideration of the legislative history contained in the House and Senate reports put to rest any uncertainty. Those reports established that Congress intended for electronic storage to be defined functionally, rather than with respect to any specific type or era of electronic communications technology. The Senate report also demonstrated that modern web-based email is functionally equivalent to the email technology in existence when Congress passed the statute, which Congress expressly intended to fall within the meaning of electronic storage. The Stored Communications Act legislative history, coupled with its plain language and an understanding of the technology at issue, constrained the court's discretion in defining the term and interpreting the statute. At the end of the day, textualists believe that courts cannot be trusted to consider legislative history because if allowed to do so, they will improperly use legislative history to support decisions that conform to their own policy preferences rather than the best reading of the statutory provision. But on this point, I agree with Professor Ettridge, who says, frankly, a result-oriented jurists will refuse to be constrained under any approach. For that reason, I believe that legal rules, like categorically barring courts from considering legislative history, does not quite solve the concerns regarding judicial activism. Instead, the best way to address those judicial activism concerns is to select judges who are committed to rigorously, faithfully, and conscientiously apply all tools at their disposal. And in doing so, do so in a manner that is transparent so as to allow courts, lawmakers, and the public to understand, apply, and to critique their reason. I'm gonna take a small pause here just to let those who are receiving CLE for this, that there is a code you need to enter, and it is called Madison 2020 should be showing on your screen in just a moment. So, far, I've applied my understanding of judicial activism in the context of classes of cases. I've contended that a court engages in judicial activism if it categorically rejects the use of a decisional tool long recognized as relevant in deciding the particular type of case. But there are also certain foundational decisional tools that judges must apply in all cases. For example, as we all know, courts should faithfully follow controlling precedent, decide only those issues that are raised by the parties, and treat similarly situated parties the same way. As Professor Eric Siegel states, Courts should not blatantly mischaracterize or ignore prior relevant decisions, distort the factual record in the case before them, or make false statements about the past. There are also particular decisional tools for appellate courts, which typically limit the issues in the factual record to be developed before the trial court, and generally defer to the fact-finding of trial judges who are in a better position to weigh the evidence and assess credibility. As Judge Tittell explained in his Madison lecture, by following these and other rules of judging, long life tenured judges across the political spectrum maximize the extent to which their decisions are driven not by personal policy agendas, but by the application of law to establish fact. Chief Justice Roberts made the same point, writing that charges of judicial activism are most effectively rebutted when courts can fairly argue they are following normal practices. That brings me to last year's decision in Rucho versus Common Cause. That's a case in which the Supreme Court held that partisan gerrymandering claims are categorically non-justiciable under the United States Constitution. I chose this case to round out my lecture because, in addition to providing a recent stark example of judicial activism closed in the language of judicial restraint, it is one that I am intimately familiar with. I sat by designation on the three-judge trial panel that reviewed this case, and I offered the trial court opinion that the Supreme Court overturned. Rucho's factual and procedural history began in 2016, when the Supreme Court affirmed a decision invalidating two districts in North Carolina's 2011 Congressional Redistricting Plan as racial gerrymandering. In response, the Republican-controlled North Carolina General Assembly set about to enact a remedial congressional districting plan. Disclaiming any reliance on race, the General Assembly's redistricting committee adopted a criteria that included certain partisan criteria. And one such partisan criterion required the legislators to rely on political data to draw a district plan that would create a partisan advantage for the Republican Party by ensuring that the Republican candidates would prevail in 10 of North Carolina's 13 congressional districts. The political data consisted of precinct level voting data, specifying whether and to what extent each precinct had favored Republican or Democratic candidates in previous statewide elections. The Republican legislator in charge of drawing the remedial plan explained the rationale behind the partisan advantage criterion as follows. I think electing Republicans is better than electing Democrats. So I drew this map to help foster what I think is better for the country. He further stated that he drew the maps to give a partisan advantage to 10 Republicans and 10 Democrats because he did not believe it would be possible to draw a map with 11 Republicans and 2 Democrats. The General Assembly adopted the remedial maps on party line votes, and the maps worked exactly as they intended. In the November 2016 election, Republican candidates prevailed in 10 of the state's 13 congressional districts, notwithstanding that Republican candidates received only slightly more than half of the statewide vote. Thereafter, several North Carolina voters and organizations filed complaints alleging that this plan expressed political favoritism and that it violated sections 2 and 4 of Article 1 of the Constitution, as well as the First Amendment and the Equal Protection Clause. The plaintiffs introduced a variety of expert analysis showing that the plans were predominantly intended to, and did, discriminate against non-Republican voters, and that the plan's discriminatory effects were not attributable to a legitimate, nonpartisan districting objective. Two expert witnesses compared the enacted plan to thousands of simulated districting plans drawn by computers using the General Assembly's nonpartisan districting criteria. The simulated maps were based on precinct level voting data from prior elections. The two experts found that relative to all simulated plans, the enacted plan was an extreme statistical outlier regarding the number of Republican candidates likely to prevail. And likewise, using the results of the 2016 election, a third expert reviewed three measures of partisan symmetry, which analyzes whether a districting plan allows supporters of the two major parties to translate their votes into seats with equal ease, and again concluded that an enacted plan was an extreme statistical outlier. The legislative defendants did not meaningfully challenge the plaintiff's statistical evidence. Instead, they argued that the plaintiffs lacked standing and the claims amounted to non-justiciable political questions because the plaintiffs had failed to identify a judicially manageable standard for adjudicating their claims. The trial court rejected the legislative defendant's standing and their justiciability arguments. The trial court stated that under the Supreme Court's opinion, controlling opinion in Davis versus Bandemer, partisan gerrymandering claims were justiciable, and the Supreme Court had never held, as the legislative defendants proposed, a claim non-justiciably solely because it purported to lack judicially manageable standards. Then for each claim, the trial court used Supreme Court precedent to set a legal standard. Standards that other courts adjudicating partisan gerrymandering claims subsequently agreed were judicially manageable. Weighing the plaintiff's evidence against those standards, the trial court concluded that the plaintiffs were entitled to prevail on each of their claims. In the meantime, other courts were considering similar challenges. One such case was the Benesec versus Lamone case, which involved Republican voters who challenged the Maryland's congressional districting plan. As in the North Carolina case in Rucho, the trial court in Benesec found that Maryland map to be unconstitutional. The Supreme Court granted certiorari in both cases, and the court recognized that the plaintiff's evidence established that the districting plans at issue were highly partisan by any measure and were blatant examples of partisanship driving districting decisions. But nevertheless, the court held that plaintiffs were not entitled to relief because no judicially manageable standard existed and could never exist for determining whether a partisan gerrymander violates the federal constitution. In reaching that conclusion, Chief Justice Roberts' majority opinion went out of its way to characterize its decision as an exercise of judicial restraint. The court stated, "We have never struck down a partisan gerrymander as unconstitutional. The expansion of judicial authority would be unlimited in scope and duration. It would occur over and over again around the country with each new round of districting for state as well as federal representatives." That led the Rucho majority to claim that voters challenging the districting plan has sought an unprecedented expansion of judicial power. But recall that under my definition of judicial activism, a decision is activist if it fails to consider or follow a well-recognized decisional tool and does so in a non-transparent fashion. Because as I will discuss, Rucho disregarded several well-established decisional tools that were materially relevant to the decision of the case. Rucho, in my opinion, is a decided activist opinion. First, the Rucho court failed to adhere to the well-established decisional tool that courts must fairly characterize parties' arguments. Restricting courts to consider those arguments that are actually raised by the parties ensures that the court does not issue an advisory opinion or resolve questions or rely on arguments that are not developed. As Justice Kagan noted in her withering dissenting opinion, which was joined in by three other justices, the majority in Rucho failed to abide by this principle. To begin with, the majority mischaracterized the legal theory proposed by the plaintiffs and that was analyzed in the trial court opinion. The Rucho majority asserted that the plaintiff's legal theory for their partisan gerrymandering claims invariably sound in a desire for proportional representation, which the Constitution does not demand. With proportional representation excluded as a constitutional baseline, the court then determined that there was no judicially manageable standard that existed to adjudicate the partisan gerrymandering claims. Now, characterizing the plaintiff's legal theory and the trial court's decision as sounding in proportional representation was critical to the majority's resolution of the case because prior Supreme Court opinions had rejected proportional representation as a constitutional baseline. It also allowed the court to devote several pages denouncing fairness as a standard before ever turning to the plaintiff's actual arguments. Yet the plaintiff's briefing and their argument to the court expressly disclaimed any reliance on proportional representation as a constitutional baseline. The plaintiffs went on to explain why the simulated maps upon which they relied were not measurements of deviation from proportional representation. Add this to the fact that the trial court opinion expressly rejected proportional representation as a constitutional standard and denied standing to those plaintiffs who only claim an injury that was alleged based on proportional representation. Justice Kagan's dissent further explained this and said that while claims were not based on proportional representation. And I recognize that when I raised this criticism, the response might be, well, of course Judge Wynn thinks that. He wrote the trial court opinion, finding that the claims were not based on proportional representation. Fair enough. But my criticism is not grounded solely in my disagreement as to the Supreme Court's conclusion on this point. Reasonable minds can disagree. That is precisely the point. Supreme Court justices, not to mention other judges and commentators, have been debating for decades whether partisan gerrymandering claims, I don't know if we're having technical difficulties this time or not, but I will check to see. Are we still in good stead? Good. For example, the trial court found that neither the expert simulation analysis nor the partisan symmetry analysis were grounded in or imposed proportional representation. Yet the Rucho majority nowhere referred to these factual findings, nor did it assert that, much explain why the trial court's findings on these points were clearly erroneous. The Rucho majority also found that it was impossible for judges to predict how a particular districting map would perform in future elections. Yet the trial court opinion made extensive findings that in this particular case, the plaintiff's evidence proved that prior election results reliably predicted how the challenged districting maps would perform in future elections. The trial court opinion identified several pieces of evidence supporting that factual finding. There's legislative map drawers use past election data to predict how the challenge map would perform in future elections and believe those predictions were reliable. Using the same past data, the experts for the plaintiff used a variety of empirical methods and sensitivity analysis to predict how the maps would perform, all which yield essentially the same result. And in a subsequent election, the map performed exactly as the map drawers and the plaintiffs predicted. But the Rucho majority nowhere addressed those factual findings, much less explained why they were clearly erroneous. Thirdly, the Supreme Court did not account for the several lines of relevant precedent, thereby skirting another meaningful constraint on judicial discretion. The precedential system developed in pre-revolutionary England and embraced by the founders indicates in what Chief Justice Rehnquist said is the even-handed, predictable, and consistent development of legal principles. It also ensures that over time, similarly situated parties are treated equally. The system does so by precluding judges from deviating from controlling precedent, and at least in theory, constraining the Supreme Court's authority to overturn precedent only to those situations in which its exacting test for overruling a prior decision is met. But in Rucho, the Supreme Court failed to consider prior relevant decisions, most notably in the court's brief discussion of the plaintiff's claims under Article 1, Section 2, Article 1, Section 4, and the latter of which is commonly referred to as the Elections Clause. In holding that invidious partisan gerrymandering violates the Elections Clause, the trial court had relied on the Supreme Court's 2001 opinion in Cook versus Grady. That was a case that the Supreme Court held that states' authority under the Election Clause extends only to neutral provisions as to the time, place, and manner of elections. Therefore, the trial court found that in accordance with the Supreme Court's 1995 opinion in Thornton versus Bryant, that the Elections Clause does not serve as a source of power for states to dictate electoral outcomes, to favor or disfavor a class of candidates, or to evade important constitutional restraints. Yet the Rucho majority nowhere referenced any of the Supreme Court's prior Election Clause opinions, including Cook or Thornton. In fact, it did not include any analysis explaining why the Elections Clause failed, except to label it novel. Likewise, regarding the plaintiff's claims under the First Amendment, the Rucho majority did not account for significant First Amendment precedent. For instance, the Supreme Court nowhere explained how its holding was consistent with precedent, establishing that the government may not impose election regulations that restrict the speech of some elements of our society in order to enhance the relative voice of others, or otherwise decide which ideas should prevail. The majority also did not explain how its decision was consistent with the Supreme Court's prior holding that when the law affords the government authority to make discretionary decisions, it may not exercise such discretion in a narrowly partisan or political manner. Nor did the majority opinion explain how its holding aligned with its prior admonition that those who govern should be the last people to help decide who should govern. Finally, the majority of the Rucho opinion discarded the well-established decisional tool of transparency. I'm not only referring to the transparency avoiding maneuvers already discussed, including mischaracterizing precedent and the party's argument. Rather, I raise another aspect of the Rucho opinion that commentators have criticized: its lack of transparency about its own rationale. The central holding of Rucho was that partisan gerrymandering presents claims that are non-justiciable political questions. But the political question doctrine comes in two flavors. The first flavor is what is called a classical approach. It emphasizes constitutional mandates. It involves the court's Article III jurisdiction. And as the Supreme Court put it in Baker versus Carr, it asks whether there is a textually demonstrable constitutional commitment of the issue to a coordinate political department. By contrast, the second form, which is called prudential, emphasizes judicial discretion. As New York University Law School's own professor, Professor Rachel Barkow, has put it, the prudential political question doctrine is not anchored in an interpretation of the Constitution itself, but it is instead a judge-made overlay that courts have used at their discretion to protect their legitimacy and to avoid conflict with the political branches. The Rucho majority cited Article 3 and discussed its own jurisdictional limitations, suggesting that the problem was one of Article 3 jurisdiction. It also looked to the text of the Constitution and noted that the only provision in the Constitution that specifically addresses the matter assigns it to the political branches. The majority concluded that there was no plausible grant of authority in the Constitution for federal courts to intervene in districting decisions. In other words, as one commentator has noted, the court evoked a classical approach, implying that its holding was mandated by the Constitution. Yet there are very good reasons to doubt this framing. The Rucho majority opinion itself emphasized prudential considerations, including concerns regarding the predictability of voters' choices, the difficulty of line drawing between acceptable and unacceptable forms of gerrymandering, a desire to avoid interjecting courts into heated partisan disagreements, and the fact that some members of Congress in some states have shown a willingness to engage the issue of gerrymandering, rendering it unnecessary, in the majority's view, for courts to be involved. Crucially, inciting the discussion of political question doctrine in Baker versus Carr, the majority quoted only Baker's prudential category of cases, not Baker's classical category. This lack of transparency allowed the Rucho majority to have his cake and eat it too. By framing this issue in classical, non-mandatory terms, the majority could throw up its hands and suggest that its decision was simply the constitutionally required solution. In other words, the majority could make a baseless claim of judicial restraint and avoid charges of judicial activism. But given the actual prudential considerations underlying its decision, the majority should have been transparent and acknowledged the discretion it was exercising. At least then the conversation around opinion would have been more honest. I would be remiss if I did not mention an additional point raised by Justice Kagan in her dissent, that the majority's abdication came just when courts across the country had coalesced around manageable judicial standards to resolve partisan gerrymandering claims. That is, the majority failed to account for significant developments ever since its 2004 opinion in Veet, where developments that may well have occurred could have resolved the very concerns that it presented. And indeed, after the court's decision in Rucho, a state court in North Carolina enjoined the use of the very maps at issue in Rucho. Though that court relied on the state, not federal constitution, it employed the same tests for the equal protection claim and relied on the same evidence that the trial court had used in Rucho. That makes the case that the test was, in fact, judicially manageable. The Rucho majority's rejection of those well-established judicial decisional tools renders Rucho an activist opinion. Now, to be clear, it is not the Supreme Court's disagreement with the party's characterization of their claims, with the trial court's factual findings, or with the applicability of its precedent to the plaintiff's claims that renders Rucho activist. It is entirely within the Supreme Court's purview to conclude that a party is not fairly characterizing its own position, or to determine that a trial court's factual finding was clearly erroneous, or to conclude that the Supreme Court's precedent is inapplicable. But when the Supreme Court refuses to engage with actual claims presented by the parties, the factual findings made by the trial court, the precedent cited by the trial court, not to mention the dissent, the opinion can only be interpreted as silently rejecting these well-established judicial decisional tools and thus engaging in judicial activism. I conclude my lecture by recognizing that judicial activism has long been and remains a loaded but ill-defined term. I've sought to provide a judge's perspective on a more useful definition, one focused on the proper role of a judge based on what courts actually do and how they explain what they are doing, rather than on the resulting outcomes. As judges, we must strive for transparency and honesty when we choose not to use well-established decisional tools developed over generations. But most importantly, we must maintain our integrity and independence as, in Chief Justice Roberts' words, an extraordinary group of dedicated judges doing our level best to do equal right to those appearing before us. That is our privilege, but more so, it is our duty. Thank you. I understand there are a number of questions that have been given to me, and one of the questions that was presented by one of you out there, the question is, do I have any ideas on how to make the judiciary selection process less political? That's a big question right now, isn't it? Many years ago, I wrote an article putting forth the thesis that striving for judicial diversity can ensure that judges, whether they are appointed or elected, are both independent and accountable to the public. I argued that, as Justice Scalia has recognized, the idea that judges will not have any predisposition in deciding cases is neither desirable nor possible. And therefore, a diverse judiciary will ensure that those predispositions better match those of the public at large. Now, true, the judiciary is always going to be underrepresented to some extent. We're all lawyers, after all. But as I wrote, ensuring diversity of racial, gender, ethnic experience helps ensure that the judge's predispositions better reflect our diverse society. So, appointing judges may give us a wide variety of experience and make the judges more representative. It can also help to reduce politicization in the judges form a wider array from the backgrounds in which they come and how they vote. Someone else asked the question, does the opinion in Rucho suggest that one person, one vote may no longer have majority support in the Supreme Court? No. Luckily, the court did not suggest that either one person, one vote, or racial gerrymandering claims are impacted by its decision in Rucho. Under the one person, one vote principle, districts within each state must have roughly equal populations, such that each person's vote is weighted roughly against the same. The Supreme Court majority distinguished one person, one vote cases from partisan gerrymandering cases by concluding that the one person, one vote rule is relatively easy to administer as a matter of math, which they believe was not true for partisan gerrymandering claims because the Constitution supplies no objective measure for assessing whether a district map treats a political party fairly. And then there was there's another question presented that indicate, recognized that I had served on the state Supreme Court, and what did I think of the proposition that state courts should decide these issues? And another asked pretty much the same question, does federal courts' abdication of their role place a greater importance on state courts? I, of course, believe that state courts have a role to play in deciding these issues. But I think it's quite preposterous that plaintiffs must rely on state courts' interpretation of state constitutions in order to vindicate their federal constitutional rights. Plaintiffs ought to be able to pursue relief in either federal or state court, and they should be able to do so by means that will enable them to seek relief And it shouldn't change from state to state, because the issue is further complicated by the fact that most state Supreme Court justices are elected. And I don't mean any respect, disrespect to state court judges by being elected. In fact, I was elected. But the reality is that individuals who are elected in partisan elections, they're more likely to feel accountable to their electorate. And at least the public may so perceive it to be in determining whether a partisan gerrymander is appropriate. So I feel that the federal court's advocation will make gerrymandering an even more heated partisan issue. So with that, I call back on my friend, Professor Gillis, as I understand you might have something to add there. I generally don't let professors ask questions, but you're given a pass today.
I can ask, you don't have to answer. I do have a question, especially in light of what you just told us. Are you worried, Judge Wynn, that in the present climate we risk losing public confidence in the federal courts as non-political institutions?
You know, I hesitate to go there with that question, but it is too obvious that with all that's going on and the recent actions, much of the public's confidence and trust in the integrity of the judicial process is being challenged. I think Chief Justice Roberts has recognized this and the need to at least present the court in a more balanced light. And I think he has fought mightily to ensure that the court's decisions are respected. The Supreme Court still enjoys a pretty high level of confidence from the voters out there. But I do fear that, and unfortunately it's becoming increasingly so, that the connection of judges with the particular president that appointed them or the party that they have been associated with will tell you the outcome of the case before you even know fully what the case is about. And that's not a good thing. Ultimately, the judicial branch needs to maintain independence. And of course, the founders, professors, you well know, the reason for giving them a lifetime appointment was to do away with that very thing. There's no fear. I mean, they can vote and choose to handle cases in any manner that they wish to handle, because there's no fear of them being taken off of the court. And the Constitution also tells you can't take their pay away. You can't reduce their pay. So there's no fear there. So, this perception, I just hope it doesn't become more of a reality, whether it's going on or now. I'm going to choose to believe that, no, we're not going there. That judges are going to do the level best to give the right answers.
Good. Well, I hope you're right. there's something of a suspension of disbelief that may be required, but when you come back for the next lecture, we'll know a lot more about that. Thank you.
Must say, this format was somewhat challenging, but I will tell you that. Yeah. It's a whole lot different game than standing up in front of people and talking, where you can move around and look around. So this was a little bit more challenging to me than I thought it would be.
Yeah. tell us about it. I mean, half of us are teaching this way. Well, thank you very much. This has been terrific. And we got an insider's view of the case because of your experience writing the lower court opinion. And obviously you have handled an appeal for us from the Supreme Court's own decision by explaining why it was wrong, or at least that's my takeaway. Judge Wynn, we'll let you go to dinner, and thank you, and I'll be in touch.
Thank you, Professor. It's a pleasure being with you.